अनंत सर?
यस मैम, आई एम हियर।
हाँ, वी वेलकम यू बैक सर टू द सेकेंड सेशन ऑफ दिस एफडीपी ऑन डेटा साइंस विद स्टैटिस्टिकल मेथड्स यूजिंग आर प्रोग्रामिंग। दिस इज द फोर्थ डे ऑफ द एफडीपी। सर, ओवर टू यू, यू कैन स्टार्ट, शेयर योर स्क्रीन एंड स्टार्ट।
श्योर। तो मनोज सर, एनी क्वेश्चन और वी कैन गो अहेड।
Sir, can you please explain the pipelining?
Yes, pipelining, that I will explain. Let me know once you can see my screen. Can you see my screen, ma'am?
It's visible, sir. It's visible.
Okay, so pipe is basically, pipe give direction to R, flow of data. So if you see here that what is we did, first of all, we did a data selection. Then we did data filter. Then we perform an operation in where we have converted character to numeric. So we need to write three different steps for three different activities. While if you want, you can write it in a single go. So your code will look like this. So what pipe says? Pipe says flow of data. I want final output. One output in one object. So what we need to do? We need to tell R that, okay, in the filter data, from the data, filter these two columns. Now we put another pipe. So what R is doing? First of all, R is picking up data and doing a subsetting out of it. Then running a filter. So now if we run this, we will get the same output as all four steps. You no need to write 1, 2, 3, 4, four different steps. You can write everything in one go. Is this clear now?
Yes, sir, it is clear. So do I have to always use the greater than symbol, or can I use any symbol?
No. For pipe, this is the defined in R.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes. Okay, now moving on to our next. Yes, sir.
This mutate function, if you can please explain this, what exactly this does?
Sir, mutate is to create or modify existing column. Using mutate, you can create new column or you can modify existing column.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sorry, sir. Hello.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, then now we are moving towards principal component analysis. So I believe you people have codes with you. We are not any data in that. We are using inbuilt data set. So first of all, any one of you know that, okay, what is principal component analysis, or ever heard about it?
No, sir.
Okay, no problem. So basically, principal component analysis is a dimension reduction technique. So when we are saying dimension reduction, that means consider a scenario, sir, that you are working on a data frame. It's a huge data frame. You can say 1 million records and 1,000 variables. Now, on this size of data set, you cannot run your standard algorithms because that will take a lot of memory and processing power. And in such kind of scenario, our variables are become correlated. So in this scenario, this is not the ideal case. So, I mean, consider an example, sir. Suppose you have one data set which has 300 rows and 50 columns. So now, if I am asking you to please study the relationship of variables, then how many pairs will be there, sir? There will be almost 1,000 pairs. And it's not at all and not advised that we are doing a relationship study using 1,000 plots. So what we can do? Here, principal component analysis comes into the picture. What principal components do, it reduces the dimensionality. Sir, its usual question comes into the interviews and people used to answer that it reduces the variable. No, principal component never reduces the variable. It always group the variable into different groups which cover most of the variation from the data. So if we are the same example that we have in our previous slide, that instead of analyzing 50 variable, we can analyze just two or three variables. That will be the linear combination. And their study is more feasible. Taking the same example, which we were discussing in the past, that if you have a three-dimensional space, and especially those faculty members who work on biotechnology and bioinformatics. So suppose you have a high dimension gene data. So you cannot analyze that data in the traditional ways. So what we used to do, we get components out of that data and then analyze those components. So if we are saying that, okay, principal, what principal component is doing, it's creating combination of different variables which have the same nature, and we are not losing information. Now, so whenever you ran a principal component analysis on your data, you always get n minus one features. So suppose you have 50 variables, so you will get the 49 components. And the first component that will have the maximum variance, that will cover the maximum. And after that, you can specify that, okay, I want to go till component 3. Then what will happen? You will, using scree-plot or other method, you will see that, okay, how many percentage of a variance is covered by those three components. Usually 80% is the rule of thumb. So wherever we are crossing the 80%, we stop there. Okay, any question till this point of time?
Sir, after reduction, will it always be n minus one or lesser number than n minus one, the components?
So you will get, ma'am, n minus one. Now it will be researcher's choice how many he want to consider for his study.
Okay, yeah. Thank you, sir.
So it comes like this. Let me show you. So suppose you have 50 variables, so you will get, 10 variables, you will get 9 principal component. PC1, PC2, PC3, like this. And each component have its own value of variation explained. Always remember, ma'am, the first one have the variation within it. So say first one has 60%. You can put as 1% only like that. So ma'am, if you can see, the sum of this will be always 100%. So you got n minus 1, but suppose you are putting a threshold of variation. So you no need to consider all this. Just pick up the top two. So instead of working with 10 variables, now you are working with variables. Is this clear now?
Sir, can you tell me what happens to the PC 10 or the 10th component in this case of example?
Ma'am, 10th component is not possible, ma'am, mathematically. Because of to create a set of it, at least one is there required. So, and these are always orthogonal to each other. So it's always comes as n minus 1.
So sir, that sir, makes only a subset of the original set.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir.
May I explain this? Because if you are having 10 variables, so if you are going to compare one with other, to always you have to pick first. You have taken the one. Now you are taking the first one with rest of the 9 variables. That's why it is maximum 9 is possible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now moving to the next part of it. So while running principal component, you should always normalize your data. So why normalization is needed? Because of it might possible, and in most of the cases, our variables are into different scales. Sometimes it looks like someone, someone is in kilometers, someone is in liter, you have a time variable which is in seconds. So you cannot use all those variables together. If you use, then what will happen? The variable with maximum variance, because of those are in different scales, will take the maximum weightage. And we never want to that situation that our solution is biased towards one variable. Yeah, so we have already covered this. Now we are implementing this into R. So it will be great if you people can open the code of principal component. Okay, so we want to start from here, and we are using the motor vehicle data from R. It's an inbuilt data set which has information about different cars and their features. Now, what I want any one of you can tell me that, okay, how many rows are there, how many columns are there, what columns are there, this information. We have already did this, so this will not be a big issue for you.
37 rows, sir, and number of column is 7.
37 rows and 12 columns. Good. Sir, how you did that?
I just run that whatever you have given code now, and running packages, I just followed that instruction.
Got it. So yes, your answer is perfectly right. 32 rows and 11 variables. Now, if we view this data set, now we have car name, its mileage, number of cylinder, displacement, horsepower of the engine, draft, weight in quintal. I don't know what is the meaning of Q second and other variables. So you can see that is along multiple units. So your mileage is into miles per gallon. Cylinders is the count data. Displacement will be your volume. Horsepower is a different energy unit of energy. So this is the reason why we required scaling part for normalization. To do so, what we need to do, we need to build one PCA model. We need to specify our data. We need to specify that a scale is equal to true if you haven't scaled it before putting into this. And then center is equal to true and rotation is equal to true. Okay, now our model is built. Now if you can see.
Sir, where the rotation is true?
This one.
REKX.
Okay, now if you see that cumulative proportion. So how many variables, columns we have in this data set? I believe 12, 11. So when you go to 11th one, the perfect example, it become 100%. Now, suppose I don't want to consider all 11. I just want that, okay, wherever 80% is consumed, we will go till that point only. So you can see principal component one, which is covering 60% of variance. Principal component two, which is covering 24% of variance. If we are putting 80% of the threshold, so usually in scientific studies, we took 80%. In social sciences, sometime we took 90%. So instead of taking 11, we are just taking the two variables. Okay, now these are your loadings, that how your particular component is derived. What is the PC1, what is PC2, likewise. Now if we plot this, so we can see it's a bit messy graph, but you can see all these are orthogonal to each other. It's a 3D graph. It might possible that it's not that visible in 2D space. Okay, so from here you can extract the standard deviation. And now if you want to compute the variance, then it's a simple square of standard deviation. Okay, now proportion of variance by scree plot. So this is one of the way. Just a second. How you can, it's a major interview question, that how you decide that, okay, how many component you should select. So one method is your mathematical way, where you are putting 80% or something. Second, this is an elbow graph or scree plot, it's called. So whenever it's this got getting flat, you can stop at that point of time. So you can see that after 4, it's almost equal to your x-axis. So your recommended number of components might be 3. Everyone following this chart? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now same for cumulative proportion. The previous one was individual one. Now this one is for cumulative one. So you can see that if you consider 80 as a cutoff, you can get principal component 2 as perfect one. So the previous one is a graphical method. This one is a mathematical method. Now, suppose you want to put cutoff as 80%, like we have discussed, or 90%, suppose someone is from social sciences. So we need to put it like this. And it's showing as 4. And now we need to just take top 4 and build our training data. So this is the place where instead of using all 11, we are just using 4 variables and running a decision tree. Okay, so any one of you, because of I believe decision tree is covered yesterday. So why I have used ANOVA here? Anyone? Okay, so when you are using decision tree for a regression problem, then you need to provide method is equal to ANOVA. Okay, so any one of you who explain what are regression problems or what are classification problems? Anyone?
Sir, regression is used for prediction, sir.
Okay.
And classification, we are classifying it into the class labels.
Correct, ma'am. So your regression are those problems where we predict some continuous variable like salary, like age, yes, like BMI. Yes. While in classification problem, what we do? We do classes, as ma'am has mentioned, like fraud or not fraud, sale or no sale, like that. And we are plotting. So if you can see, if your principal, it's a based on principal component, it found it significant. So wherever, instead of using the entire 11 variable, we got the solution with 4 variables only. Any question till this point of time? Okay, if no question, then ma'am, let's put this as a hands-on for next, say 30 to 40 minutes. If anyone will face any problem, then we will discuss. Is that okay?
Okay? Recording is on, sir. It is going on because yes, we have to.
Yes, ma'am.
It's on.
Please,
sir, there is one question.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Sir, you have explained PCA, principal component analysis. Can we use PCA for the feature selection for high dimensional data?
Ma'am, there are two parts of it when you say feature selection. So there are two parts of it. First is feature creation, then feature selection. Yes, definitely you can use PCA for feature creation. And out, once you are done, then using PCA, you can create, you can pick up all those features which have the maximum contribution to your solution. So it's better we put this in two parts. First feature creation, then feature selection. If you refer to this code, ma'am, answer to your question, here what we are doing, we are creating variables in the model, line number 13 to 14. And after doing all the exploratory data analysis, in line number 59, we are doing, sorry, line number 63, we are doing a feature selection.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So let me know if anyone has any problem. I am here.
Omti ma'am, do you want to say something? Omti ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you want to say something?
Ma'am, I have one doubt, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Sir, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I am.
Okay. Ma'am is asking.
Sir, is the sir, is principal component analysis is necessary for deep learning frameworks, sir?
No, ma'am. Deep learning is a different arena altogether, ma'am.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Then for feature selection and all, you have convolution methods, etc.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thanks.
I hope everyone is doing the practice session. Hands on. Okay, one person is doing only. Many people are doing fine.
Hello, good evening, ma'am. Sorry, good afternoon. I'm back. Hello.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Yes, I'm here. Sir, you can continue with your session because time is running out.
Yes, ma'am. So the next session, the next topic that we are going to cover are functions. So as most of us from computer science or scientific background, so if we say that, okay, define a function to a layman, then what will be the definition? Anyone from the audience? Okay, no problem. So programmatically, functions are like a set of code, I mean, few lines of code, where you put some inputs and that will give you an output. Okay, so similarly, in like other languages, are two types of functions, system defined and user defined. So system defined functions, either those are embedded in R or they are embedded into libraries. So libraries also have functions. Now, when we are moving to libraries, those functions are readily available on CRAN, as we discussed in the past. But sometimes it's that in R, we need to write our own function, our life easy. And this is one of the important point in any of you should know how to mold that language as per your requirement. Okay, now, so as we discussed, there are two types of functions. One, system defined, another one is user defined. So the classic example, and most of the time we consider this example all that, what is the generic anatomy of a function in R? Can you see my screen? So first of all, we need to give a unique name to the function. So say my function. And then suppose second parts are arguments. So argument one, argument two, and likewise, we can have n number of arguments. Then what we need to do, we need to define the function body here. So you, whatever work you want your function should do, it will define here. So there are three parts of it. One, function name. Second, number of arguments. And the third one is your function body, in which you define that, okay, what your function will do. So suppose you want to write a function to greet someone. Okay. So you will write like my greet function. And then what will be your argument? Guest name. These are put in the way so that it should be easily understood by another person who is referring your code. So the argument is guest name. Now, what you want your function should do? Your function should greet the customer. So print So do you know why we use paste? Anyone? Anyone? Why we use paste in R? Okay. So the paste is used to concatenate multiple values together. So suppose the guest name is MIT. What it's saying that, hello, MIT. Like, you can build your own functions in R. The classic example, conversion of Celsius into Fahrenheit. So anyone who want to take this initiative, I will be there to help you. Anyone want to try this, how to write a function to convert Celsius into Fahrenheit? Anyone? I'm going to help you.
Yes, sir, I want.
Oh, please go ahead and share your screen. Thank you. I can't see your screen, sir. Well, sir, are you sharing something?
Sir, I'm using mobile to connect your program, but I'm doing in my laptop. So if I after completing it, I will take a snapshot and send.
Sure. Thank you. Anyone want to give a try on screen? We are here to help you.
Yes, sir. I'm there, sir.
Yeah, please share your screen.
No permission to share the screen, sir. Only meeting
Member,
organizers.
Allow, sir, to...
Yes.
Rahul, sir, now you can share your screen.
Yes, sir. Is it my screen is visible?
Yes, sir. We can see your screen.
Yes, sir. So I just define the function Celsius to Fahrenheit in short. That is CLC2 FPR equal to function. And I just take the one parameter, that is temperature in Celsius actually. And then I just convert it into the Fahrenheit, and the formula is Celsius into 9/5. I just put it in a bracket plus 32. So it will convert the Celsius temperature into the Fahrenheit.
Yes. Sir, let's discuss a scenario here. Suppose any one of user who forget to enter the value and he directly ran your code, then
which value, sir?
Suppose to run this function, we need to provide some value. I mean, how to run this function?
Okay, we have to call the function.
Yes, please do that.
So here the function name is search for here, and within this I just pass on the value like 10 Celsius.
And
then it will call the functions whatever I define here. So I just run, first I just execute these lines of code, then I just execute this line calling of function, and I just assign this to some variable like I just put here data equal to this one. This will and print the data here. So it will give me the answer 50. The temperature in Fahrenheit is 50, and earlier it was 10 Celsius.
Yes. So just create one more experiment with this. So suppose in your case, we need to provide this 10. What will happen if we are not providing any argument?
So without argument, I just said without argument. Okay. So I just call this function.
So then how will you deal with this situation? I mean, why I am doing this, so that we should be.
It's a default. Default. You just mentioned the default earlier in that case.
Correct. Like please I go ahead and here, define a default value.
Temp equal to 10, suppose it's my defined value. And suppose I'm not passing any value, then that 10 will be executed. Here, I'm not passing any value right now. At the calling time of function, then it will give me the 50. The answer is 50. Okay. But if suppose again, at this calling function, I just pass here 30, then it will take the value 30, not the 10.
Yes.
Yeah, it's right, sir.
Yes, that is correct. And one more point, sir. Suppose in a situation, so here what we are doing, we are not returning anything.
Okay.
Ideally, it should get returned.
Yeah.
So you need to specify one return argument in the body.
Okay, return statement, you say.
And it will be great if you can explain others that what is the significance of return statement.
Return statement just return the value to our whatever that value is calculated, that function calculated value is returned to our this data variable. If I mentioned statement.
And in case we didn't,
and then that value will not be assigned to this data variable like this within this console screen where I just print the data, but the value is not will be printed here. But in the environment variable here, the data value is 50.
Correct. Thank you so much, sir, for this explanation part. And I believe one of us is currently working on the data on functions. So sir, let me know once you are done.
So can I answer, sir?
This yeah, please, sir. Thank you so much for your participation, sir.
Welcome, sir.
So let us know once you are done. Sir, may we move ahead? Okay, so considering that the participant is working on it, we are moving ahead to our next part of the session, that is the advanced visualization of data. So I am just sending this script to ma'am, and then we will start.
Okay, via mail?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
Sent, ma'am. Okay, so we are starting with another part that we discussed in our one of the previous discussion, the presentation. Presentation is a very important aspect of your so findings. How you think?
I have to share this flavors wala file again. I have to share everything.
Ma'am, there are two files, one R file and one CSV.
Uh-huh. Both.
Please send. Yes, ma'am, both one.
Okay, okay.
Okay. So now if we start with any one of you who, most of us are PhDs. I mean, I think all of us are PhDs. So why data visualization is important in research? Anyone want to take this question?
Yes, sir. Getting the insights in very short notice or the short insights. If I look up the data in the tables, then it will take more time or the more concentrations. Or instead of that, if that data I represent on the bar chart, pie chart, then I will make some insights or the decision very easily or very quick.
Very correct, very you have summarized in a very good way. So the visualization always help us in understanding the key insight from the data very quickly, instead of if we have a long table and if we want to compare multiple tables. So it's not easy for us, but if we have some good data sets with good visualization, it's easy for researcher to interpret the results, compare different findings. So I believe you people have data with you. And so we will discuss the data first. After that, we will go ahead visualization part.
I have sent
the data. As you can see, sorry, ma'am.
I have sent the data in WhatsApp group. Please download from there. Got it?
By the time, ma'am, people are downloading it, let's discuss this data. So this data has 9 variables. So basically, this is nothing, just feedback data for different companies chocolate flavor. So the first column, you know, is company, brand, when referred, review year, OCA percentage, where the company is located, what is the rating, what is the bean type, and what is the broader market, I believe. So this is the data that we have. We have 9 rows and 1,795 records. I believe everyone is following me till this point of time. Okay. So now, as we are doing earlier, we are starting with loading our libraries. So to do so, we are starting with tidyverse. Because of we have discussed already a lot about tidyverse, any one of you, why we use tidyverse in R, if there is a question.
To visualize the data.
Correct. Anything else? Okay, so this tidyverse is a large library. As we know that this is not a library as such, this is a family of library. So if you go to tidyverse website, you find that there are n number of packages which are part of tidyverse. And these are the official one, and many are the unofficial one also. So if you see here, we have dplyr. So why dplyr is used? Dplyr is used for data manipulation. Plot 2, ygg-plot is 2, that is data visualization. Reader is to deal with your structured data, mostly for data import. String R is for dealing with string data. Tibble, forecats, and tidyr. These are also data management structures. And per is a library which you can use to deploy your service. So basically, tidyverse is not a library as such. It's a family of library that we have already discussed. Now, moving to the next part. That is GG themes. So GG themes is nothing but these are different themes. Usually what happened in general that we got a just white background in our charts. But as this course is based on advanced graphics, so we will cover many points like how is the graphics of graph, I mean the background graphics instead of a white background, we will get some themes. So those comes from here. Stringer, we have already, and Janitor, we already discussed for data manipulation. And Stringer is majorly for deal with string data. Now, again, we are setting the working directory. And then we are setting up, we are importing the data. Okay, so now if we go ahead, can any one of us can inspect this data for us and share his or her findings? Any one of us will. Okay, let me do this inspection for you. So we have imported this data. So we will start with how many rows and columns are there. So we take str. So what it's saying, there are, it's a table and there are 9 variables and 1,795 observations. The first one, the company, the data type is character. Second one, specific bean origin or bar name, it's also character. Then you have reference, then you have review date, then you have COCA percentage, company location, rating, bean type, and then we have broad bean origin from where the it created. So this is the structure that we have. Now, what we are going to do, we are going to inspect the data. So again, we will just took a head of it and view. So how many rows I can expect any one of you in this operation of line number 16? What is the default output of head function?
5.
6, sir.
Okay, yes.
In Python, we have 5. Okay, now. So you can see that your column names are in proper format. So ideally, while renaming column in R, you should keep few things in mind, like there should not be any special characters. There should not be spaces. If R can manage spaces in the variable name, but it's not recommended to put spaces in the variable name. To do so, what we will do? We will run a cleaning on variable name. So we will clean our data. Now, if you see, can someone identify the changes? Anyone? Now there are no spaces, wildcards, etc. We just have proper clean variable names. Okay, so once the data cleaning is done, if you can hear that it's not, still values are not cleaned properly and we have a percentage sign is here. So if we have any sign here, then it will always be in a character format. So we need to take off these percentages. So we will. Now if we see our data, no percentage is there and it's a properly aligned column. Now, we are starting with our first plot, that is using ggplot. And let's see. So what is the basic anatomy of ggplot? So first of all, you need to define data. That okay, what data set you are using. Then you need to tell that okay, what X you want, what Y you want. So I believe everyone is comfortable with these notations. Or do I need to add some more content around this? Okay. So X is nothing. X is what we are plotting on the X axis. So what we are plotting, the coca percentage. And we are plotting Y on the Y rating and try to establish a relationship. So we will go one by one. So if you see here, nothing will come because of few more points need to be added. Okay, now you need to tell ggplot2 that what do you want any smoothing? Do you want to add some text? Or do you want to add some title on the Y axis, some title on the X axis? So you can define all those things here. You need to supply all the informations here. And now you can see because of the graph is at a line level, so it's not that great, but you can see there is a downward trend in the rating. So you can say people don't like or that company, people don't like those chocolates which have high coca percentage. While we are having good ratings where we have less percentage of coca. Are you people aligned on this statement? Okay, no problem. Again, we are going for another graph, which is the rating with competitor. The same one, same logic. Now, what we are doing here, we are subsetting few things. So, as someone has asked in our previous discussion that what are the benefits of these pipes? So you can see, we are doing here multiple operations together. So we are doing a filter here. And then we are creating a bar chart here. So what you are seeing here, that in the dot blend, Carillo, and these are different coffees which have their participation. So maximum sale goes to this coffee, followed by blend and others. Similarly, if we want to add some colors, so we can see here, I mean, it's a bit clumsy graph, but if we are in doing analysis by country, by bean type, so we can see that in US, the maximum participation is coming from, and from Amsterdam, it's also. So here you can compare sales of this coffee across countries. And suppose one country, and suppose we want to just analyze for UK, US, and India. Let's see. So we can put the country, the company location. And in company location, we can put a vector here as UK, US, suppose. Now, if you run this, now the picture is more clear for you. You can see on the left side, let me fit my screen. Yes. On the left side, it's US side, it's sorry, UK and US, and you have respective sales in place. So you can compare few countries, multiple countries, etc. Now, any problem till this point of time?
Sir, can we change this color of these bars?
Yes, sir, you can do this, but right now we are covering as a standard theme. You can browse more themes in the ggplot2 and from where you can control the color of these charts.
Okay.
So you can get it from here. Just search ggplot themes. So here is the massive collection of ggplot themes. So you can create your own theme from here. Okay. And they have given you the example also. And these are the basic theme which comes with ggplot2. So you have example here. So if you want to reset your themes as per your requirement, you can do it from here. Is this answer to your question?
Not really, but I'll explore this.
No, let me know. I mean, where we are lacking.
So basically, when we are using Excel for visualization, mm-hmm. we have options mm-hmm. to we get different colors which we can choose for different bars or different lines. So that is what I was talking about.
Okay, so likewise here, so you have color options here.
Okay, yeah, so this is what I was asking about. Yes,
so you can there is a massive documentation is available, and this is an online book only for ggplot2.
Okay,
you can get it for free, and its codes, everything is available. You can get it from here. Okay, now moving to the aggregation. So can anyone of us discuss that aggregation and how it's helpful in research? So aggregation is nothing, just summarizing your data on the basis of few criteria. So suppose you want average sale with respect to store, you want average marks with respect to campus subjects. So all these are aggregations. So as you can see in this, in 2007, 8, 9, 10, 11, what is the average rating we have? So the black line is the average rating and the blue line is the trend. And now let's add a theme out of it. So here you can see it's a simple gray themed. Now what you can see here, we have added more clear way. Now we have a good font size here. We have good background. So all these themes will help you in making your visualization more attractive. Okay, so now few more themes which I want to talk about. So this was the theme economist. Now we have 538. This is just a theme name. So you can see here. And now the last theme that I am talking about is Excel. That's what you have asked. Like this. So this is the last part which I was covering in the building data science solutions. So we have covered the data, we covered the visualization, and we covered the PCA. Now moving forward, what we will do, we will start with the time series. So I believe let's make another hands-on session for say half an hour. You people have code with you. Please explore the code, run it on your machine, experiment with it. Sorry, sir. Oh, sir, can you come again? Hello. Oh, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are okay. Audible.
Okay, thank you. So I believe most of us have this data and code with us. So let's move ahead and we will do a hands-on session, and then ma'am, what I mean, as ma'am suggest. Hello.
Anand sir, are we continuing or?
Ma'am, the visual advanced visualization is done from my side.
Okay.
So there are two options available now that if participant want, then they can continue with hands on for say next 15 minutes.
Hmm.
Else, we can continue with the time series. Or in the next session.
In the next session, we can take up the time series, sir.
Sure, ma'am.
So we break for 45 minutes. We meet by 2:30.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Is that clear? We meet by 2:30, all of you. We take a break of 45 minutes. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining.
Thank you.